Councillor Carr, what do you think of these ideas? Would you support them if some of the people in this room came forward to rezone Fraser Street and...
I'll ask
us questions. No, you can comment on that first. It's not a rhetorical question.
You know, Michael, I come to your talks because I am intrigued. My question actually was going to be to you, what would you say to me as a counselor are the most important changes to bylaws or policy or whatever in order to facilitate greater density at that lower to medium rise? Not low as a single family, but four-story stacked townhouses, etc.
Well, I'm going to answer part of that, and then maybe some of the other architects in the room who are struggling to do C2 projects can tell you what they'd like to see, especially when you want to see family units and so forth. I think the first thing is the whole zoning process. I mean, we have created this system which is completely wrong if you think about it. Why should I be the one coming forward to say that an apartment building would fit on this site? Either your planning department and your municipal officials think it's a good idea or not. You should take the initiative. So to my mind, the first thing is it should be the municipalities that are developing overall plans and the more detailed neighborhood plans for property and putting in place zoning. Now, some do it. Port Coquitlam does it. In Surrey and Richmond, they don't quite pre-zone, but there's such a high degree of certainty that you don't feel it's such a huge risk. But in other municipalities today, even if there's an official community plan, there's an element of risk. Councillor Hicks is here from District North Vancouver. A developer came forward with a 21-suite, three-story apartment building that it conformed entirely with the official community plan because I was a consultant on it until he was fed up with how long it was taking. But the point was the only way he could get that rezoned was by promising not to start construction until 2018 when some of the other developments that were underway were completed. And this is in an area of North Vancouver that I think desperately needs a broader range of housing choices. So that if we could try to reduce that element of risk and the cost that comes with it, because very often the only way some developers can operate is they don't actually want to go and buy all those properties and then take the risk. They'll option them, and then after a year, they then make additional option payments, and then sometimes they have to decide, do they close on the land or walk away and so forth. But maybe some of the architects in the room who are doing multifamily in the city or others would like to comment on that. David Goodman?
Yes.
Are you the David Goodman of the Goodman Report, who's always in trouble?
Michael, you're a brave sort. I think you've...
Could you stand, David? Would
yes.
You stand? Thank you.
Michael has cited clearly some of the frustrations in getting new ideas put forward. I think most of the planners in Metro Vancouver have a sense of adventure and would like to depart from these fixed ideas that have been around so long. There's very little in the way of innovation in Metro Vancouver. I cast a pointing finger really at the politicians. It's the politicians that set the mood and the climate. They react poorly to NIMBYism, which is clearly evident throughout Metro Vancouver, more so in Vancouver and some of the higher density areas like Richmond and North Shore. I would say that you should lock all the planning departments and all the politicians in one of your seminars without the public and actually go toe-to-toe with them, because clearly you've introduced a number of breathtakingly interesting notions from Europe. I'm sure many of them would go over well here. Developers here have an awful lot of patience, but when it comes to new ideas. The same old ideas seem to be the line of least resistance. And new innovative ideas takes 5 years, if you're lucky, to get through any city administration because there is a violent pushback. The planners are carrying out the instructions of the politicians, and as a result, they have been reduced to simply bureaucrats without the ability to do innovative things.
All right, so now I'm going to ask Susan Chappell from the District of Squamish, who is a politician, to respond to that.
Thank you. I appreciate that, and we're not elected because of our brains. We're elected because we oppose something, or not because we have any experience in city planning or in accounting or in understanding city finances. We're elected by our public for reasons that often we don't even understand when we get in. So, and I couldn't agree with you more, but I have to explain to my public when I come forward with an innovative idea and say, I'd like to put medium density housing, and they say, but a developer has just offered me millions of dollars for my small single family home because they expect rezoning for high density towers, and they feel that the idea of density is being pushed, and we don't really understand, because we don't get out much, is that, you know, what is an innovative idea and what works? And we see low density as being pushing back on the idea of affordable housing and of walkable neighborhoods. But, you know, I think this works great here, and I would love to have my small town. We don't have regional transportation. We don't have access to services. We don't have, we can't walk in our neighborhoods. It's a car-oriented development. So I asked Michael Geller, back at you, buddy, is how, I don't see a lot of parking going on here. And when you don't have the same transit facilities that Europe does, and you can't act regionally, how do you implement ideas of low density in areas that are not yet walkable?
And in fact, Rick Fluff asked exactly that question this morning. Those who may have caught his early edition show, he said, you know, because transportation is absolutely key. And I think you're right. A lot of these projects that I've shown you are connected to transit in a much more profound way than so many of our developments. But we are getting better. But as Andy mentioned at the beginning, I worked on my first big project in Vancouver was the redevelopment of the South Shore of False Creek from an industrial area into a new housing community in the mid-1970s. And the then mayor was Art Phillips. And Art Phillips wanted this to be a transit-oriented community. In fact, the tagline for some of the condos was "Work in Vancouver, live in Europe." BC Transit, as it was then called, said it wouldn't run a bus line to the community because there weren't enough people living there. Philip said, I want a bus there the day the very first resident moves in. And he got it. And the way he got it was by asking CMHC, for whom I worked, whether we would agree that there could be a levy on every unit within the development. $5 per unit per month, whether it was ownership or rental, to generate a pot of funds which were then given to BC Transit to subsidize the bus service until such time it was fully operational. Now, I'm not suggesting that that necessarily is the answer in other places, but I think what it says is that maybe we just have to come up with some more creative ideas to figure out how to get the transit, if you like, to get some form of transit in place or an alternative to the private vehicle. When we did the SFU community, we obviously had the luxury of wonderful transit. We had all those buses coming up in the morning that were going down empty. But we also had the reverse in the evening. So we were able to do something there. In that case, what we did was we offered the residents a discounted transit pass as part of the trade-off for living there, but they didn't get two parking spaces with their unit. The other thing we did was we tried to get a car share. I must confess, at the time, I thought car share was only for people who wore Birkenstock sandals. But a lady, his name's going to come back in a second, who started the co-op Tracy Axelson, who had done for her SFU thesis the notion of a car co-op, she said it could work. We couldn't get the car co-op to set up at SFU because they weren't sure if anybody would use it. So we bought a Prius and gave it to the co-op to say, look, at least now you've got a car. But the point is, I think we need to start to do some of these other things, whether it's buying cars for developments in return for a reduced parking requirement, or as Jim McIntyre was saying this afternoon, allowing more tandem parking as an alternative to having side-by-side double car parking, and requiring, as we're starting to do, more car share parking spaces. Bit by bit, I think we're getting somewhere. And the fact is, we have now done developments in Vancouver with significantly reduced parking requirements. I personally feel that if a developer is willing to build an apartment building with no parking spaces for the residents, he should be or she should be allowed to do it. I would actually insist on some parking for the visitors, because often it's the visitors who create more of a problem than the residents. But there's no doubt that this notion of marrying transit and parking, which is what they do in Germany, has to happen. Robin, what are your parking requirements in the district of North Vancouver if we want to do townhouses?
I'm not a planner, I'm an accountant, but I think we are reducing them, and I would like to see it reduced even more so. And I just like to respond to the comments about the politicians. And to your comment, I think politicians should be skilled and should be experienced. I think there are too many politicians who are ignorant of finance, economics, lots of other things. And once they get into office, they just want to become re-elected, and then they make the decisions which curse favor with the NIMBYs to stay in office. And as a result of that, we've got a 4-3 split on council on almost every decision. Now, fortunately, it's the right decision that we're going ahead with developments. But, and I don't care if I don't get re-elected, but the ones that do are pandering to the people and say, who are complaining about traffic, and saying all the development brings more traffic, which to some degree is true, but unless a promise where somebody steps up and starts saying we've got to have public transportation and price cars off the roads, to put it in an extreme way, we're not going to get anywhere. So a benevolent dictator like Yang Kuan Yew from Singapore will be the solution to all our problems in transportation, etc. But I thoroughly agree with all your comments and your about new design variation. I think we're so boring with the sameness everywhere. And I could go on and on about this, but well, I probably won't be re-elected now. So
well, it's funny you should mention that, because I was telling someone today that I'm going to be basing my property assessment appeal on the fact that in the district of North Vancouver, just because a property is designated in the OCP doesn't necessarily mean it'll get rezoned in accordance with that OCP. And when something like that happens, it becomes very distressing. But Jim Cheng, do you want to address Councillor Carr's question about what things need to be done to make it a little easier to be creative and do it?
I agree with your first comment that the planning job should be the planning department. They should do the overall development and not up to the individual to apply on the individual basis.
Louder, please.
Michael, you can repeat.
Yeah. Well, what Jim is saying is that he agrees that even though he's been incredibly successful, I might add, at coming forward with buildings and getting them approved, buildings that others might never have thought would fit into a particular location, you'd still be happier if we had a system where the planners determine what the overall look of a community is going to be, and then you don't keep changing them just because somebody's come along. I mean, what you mentioned Singapore. One of the most interesting things in Singapore is they have the equivalent of an urbanarium. It's a city museum, and there's a giant model. And I don't know why Alan James is smiling here, because when I wrote a column that was praising Singapore and lauding its achievements, he responded that Singapore to him was nothing more than a giant hotel lobby, which I thought was cruel. But the one thing I did like is there's a level of certainty. And when they do that master plan of the city and the zoning, when people come along, they make a model and they fit it in.
Thank you.
I think you should also mention that over 80-some percent of the housing in Singapore is developed by the government. Mm-hmm. And there is not affordability crisis in Singapore.
Yeah.
And I think we should learn from them.
Councillor Cameron?
I just want to respond to something Mr. Goodman said, because I think it actually needs to be said. I don't think Robin or Susan really touched on it. Leaving aside the crass politics of trying to get reelected, which Mr. Goodman is blissfully unconcerned with because it doesn't affect him, but even if you're like Robin and you don't necessarily care if you're going to be reelected or seek reelection, it comes down to philosophically what you believe your role as a councillor is. And although, as you know, Michael, I love this sort of development, and I personally, it's where I would like to see us going, I don't believe my job as a councillor is to shove my ideas down the community's throat. I think there's always going to be, inevitably, a balance between bringing the community along, showing leadership, and moving in new directions, and also being cognizant of where the community is. And I think if you push too hard, too fast, it's going to have the reverse effect, and you're going to get people reacting and consolidating and resisting it. So what I think developers should do, and I do think councils need to provide leadership, but what developers and councils should be doing, in my view, is trying to address some of the concerns that aren't all illegitimate, yeah, that people have, and trying to do things like approach things incrementally. For example, if we do an infill development here and there in Ambleside, my hope is the community will see, well, Hollyburn Mews, which you developed, was thought, well, this is going to destroy the neighborhood. There was residents who were banging the table at the council meetings before I was on council saying this is going to destroy the neighborhood because you were putting a duplex and a coach house on a single family lot, or three of them. But as it turned out, you developed it, and it's occupied, and I think the general consensus in the neighborhood is that they're the nicest houses in the neighborhood. So I do think there's an element of bringing the community along, of showing leadership, but also being sensitive and responding to some of the concerns. And that has to be a collective enterprise between council, staff, and the developer. And if we pit it as you know, just chicken councils, not showing the leadership, I think you're missing all that nuance and you're not describing the situation correctly.
Before I take the question up there, just one observation. Sometimes I think a key to getting things done is to, in fact, do demonstration projects. So in other words, before you rezone the entire city, maybe you do allow someone to come along and do a six-story building on Dunbar, and see how it looks. Now, the trouble is, when there's just one, it won't look as wonderful as when there's a row of them. But sometimes, if people could think that you are at least doing something on a demonstration, so I'm arguing against myself a bit, but that does help, because people need to see these things, I think, on the ground. Yes, right there?
So, I'm a developer, and I've seen the presentation. I think great ideas that are coming forward. But from a risk perspective, I can tell you my experience. I'm not going to mention which city I developed in, but I put forward a stack townhouse development, and it took me 2 years for a three-story stack townhouse development to get approved, which, you know, with a level of certainty that this, which the zoning already was there. For the density, my allowed density, it took me 2 years to get it approved. And literally, I just got my building permit 2 days ago. With extremely high carrying costs of the land, and I was asked to reduce my density by 20%. And I'm talking about an FSR of less than 1.5, and producing, only 65% of my density was being targeted towards three bedrooms and more. And I was asked to reduce my density. And again, I want to mention which was...
So what was the concern with the application that made it take so long?
I think it was an innovative, only less than 10 projects have been built in the entire city based on this, and on this concept. So coming back to innovation, and instead of encouraging innovation through fast-tracking processes and so on, I pushed along until the point that I was able to be able to build that city, because otherwise the project would have been unfeasible. So my question to you is, how do other cities that you've seen, whether in America, whether in Europe, or other parts of the world, how do they reward innovation? And I'm talking about whether it's green innovation, I'm talking about whether it's sustainable from all aspects, to encourage these types of developments and not discourage, like I was, and really kind of saying, well, I'm not going to build that city anymore, or I'm really just going to change my business model so that it's I'm going to have to build what I'm asked to do, is stick to my cookie cutter, to the cookie cutter net.
I'm not sure I can answer that the way you want, somebody else may want, but I can mention that my last job at CMHC was as a director of something called the Research and Demonstration Group. And so we were a unit that would go across the country trying to encourage new forms of housing and new forms of development in municipalities with mixed success. I say mixed success because I remember spearheading a compact housing proposal with narrower street rights of way and reduced setbacks in Revelstoke. And when I presented it to the local builders, they all sort of said, oh, this is never going to work here, this is never going to work here. I said, the trouble with people like you is you're just simply not open to new ideas. And we built the project, and after the first winter, and I saw how much snow there was, I realized they were absolutely right. And we actually had to knock down 3 units just to have a place to pile the snow. So the point is, sometimes these things don't work. But we were able to do that demonstration project because the municipality and the mayor and everybody was keen to see something happen. And they were bribed a little bit. There was some sort of benefit that came along with it. Sometimes, I guess, bribing people is a really good way to get them to do things they otherwise don't want to do. Now we bribe people with community amenity contributions. But one of the reasons I did this and one of the reasons I went on the radio this morning is I do want to see if we can just get more and more people talking about these ideas and showing pictures of developments. And I actually do think, and it's happening already. I mean, Canby Street is an example. Whether you like it or not, it is an example of a new approach to increasing the density. Stacked townhouses, I mean, I know. I saw stacked townhouse development. I couldn't believe it. Like, because they didn't know how to deal with it. It didn't fit with any of the rules and regulations. And maybe there's a role there sometimes for the municipal officials to trade stories with one another. I've often found if you can't get the fire marshal to approve something, if you can show him that another municipality or city that has a responsible fire marshal that they did it and everybody's not burning to death, they may be more amenable to doing it. But at the end of the day, I do think showing people examples, on-the-ground examples of what you're trying to do is sometimes a good way to convince them.
It's certainly the beautiful, unique architecture that has emerged from that. What are the general sizes of the units? Like, are they 500 square feet? Are they, 2,000 square feet? Like, how does it interface towards actually living in the units?
Well, I think you see the same sort of variety in unit size that we see, although there's no doubt in some European cities the tendency is for slightly more compact spaces, but then one might say, can you get anything smaller than what we're building in Vancouver sometimes? Although I see that the planners of Vancouver are concerned about micro-suites. In the case of those floating homes, for instance, they range between 1,000 and about 1,400 square feet. But some of these townhouses are larger because they're on multi-levels. But by the way, one of the things I didn't dwell on, had I taken more time to show the English townhouses, you would have seen they always have a suite at the lower level. And that's another thing that I think we should be doing. All right, we've got two more comments here, and I think we'll wrap it up because people that want to go home and watch Occupied, that wonderful new Norwegian television series. Yes?
So I have a good authority that some municipalities will incentivize single-family homeowners to accept rezoning by letting them share in the profit of the land value increase. That doesn't happen in Vancouver. I'm wondering if that's something that would help people accept multifamily zoning.
So I don't know, did you all hear the question? Rumor has it in some municipalities, rather than see the municipality take any land lift or profit from a rezoning, the property owners themselves somehow sharing it. Well, I suspect that even in Vancouver, property owners are benefiting from rezoning. And if you need an example, just look at Oak Street. I did the first, what I'm told was the first rezoning to go from single family to apartments at 42nd and Oak. And in that case, we did do it. I didn't have enough money to buy the four lots. So what I basically said is, I'll give you $1,000 now, but when they're rezoned, I'll give you what those properties are worth. And they ended up getting more than three times the original value. And we do see that happening. But generally speaking, I think when properties are rezoned, there does seem to be a land lift. Part of the problem I see, though, is that then you're continuing this cycle of creating unaffordable housing. I mean, I was told, and somebody may verify this, that some of the lots on Oak Street that are now being converted into those townhouse developments, some of which are quite attractive, are now approaching $5 million each. Because developers are, there's enough certainty that they're going to get the rezoning that they're willing to pay. Now, my point there is if all of Oak Street was rezoned, they wouldn't get $5 million, and the end price of the units wouldn't be 1.3. I'll be absolutely blunt. I should never say this. But I can always charge far more for a project if I don't have any competition nearby. But if there's competition nearby, all of a sudden you're much more conscious of just trying to price it so that it's going to work in terms of the overall marketplace. That, to my mind, is an argument in favor of a much broader based zoning change.
Mike, your point was a great one to end on. I'm fine. We'll leave it at that.
Okay. All right, Andy Yen, you're going to tell everybody they can go home now?
I hope so. Well, thank you, Michael, for giving a wonderful tour of Europe, as always. It's been intriguing and challenging, and I think that I'll remember this tactic of going, that the best defense is a good offense, into the audience. And thank you so much, Michael. I hope to see everybody at the next series of public events that we have over the 6th program.